Good morning. Good morning. Welcome all, and thank you for being in workshop 170, which is developing a national regional framework. So, do you hear me clearly? Oh, okay. Welcome to workshop 170, which is developing a national regional framework of principles for internet governance. I would like to thank you all. It is the third day already. We are filled with the events on the IG, so good to see you here. Thank you, Paul. And I would like to welcome also the panelist, Jane Coffin from ISOC, Paul Rendick. We have Olga Cavalli coming soon, hopefully, after she finishes a parallel workshop, and Billy Drake, and hopefully Carlos Alfonso. Actually, we are planning to conduct the workshop in an open dialogue format. We are not a panelist as much as participants with you. This is to share ideas, to exchange views on the importance of having regional or national frameworks of principles on internet governance. The purpose of the workshop is to see whether this idea is important. Is it an option that we can have right now? Is it needed or it is not needed? So actually, the purpose of this workshop is to engage in a dialogue rather than making a presentation or speak. We want to conduct it in an interactive format. I will just go through a brief description of the questions that we are addressing in this workshop, just to give you an idea. And then we will move on to our main panelist. The first question really that pops up to our mind is a framework of principles for internet governance is needed on a national or regional levels, and how it can play a role in improving internet usage to all relevant stakeholders. Question two, can the framework of principle for internet governance replaces regulation on national or regional levels? In what areas related to IG it can be applied, and in what other areas of IG regulation still will be the most suitable approach. Question three, what type of a process can be adopted to develop the national / regional framework of principles on internet governance? How can we ensure that this process will be inclusive, multi-stakeholder, and what steps that should be included in this process? Question four, in what ways consent on national level and regional level can be reached to adopt this framework, and in what ways or means it can be brought into effect? The fifth question is, are there currently examples of such frameworks? Do they exist? So from that point, I will move on to our first panelist, Ms. Jane Coffin of ISOC, and I'll pass the floor to her.
Good morning, colleagues. Thank you very much. My first comments are going to be a bit provocative. I'm going to lay the framework and then ask you to think about what we're putting forward. Paul will speak and the others may join us. But again, this is a collaborative dialogue. Based on many other principles that may be out there, whether it's an OECD principles, your own principles in your countries, we're trying to think of what we know works in different countries, whether it's a regulatory process, a bottom-up multi-stakeholder process, a civil society process. Do we really need them in a collective agreed whole in a country or in a region? Is that something that's going to create more of a framework that's hard to maneuver or be flexible in? I'm going to read you a definition of collaborative governance that I found on Wikipedia. It says, collaborative governance is a process and a form of governance in which participants, parties, agencies, or stakeholders, representing different interests are collectively empowered, that's an important word, to make a policy decision or make recommendations to a final decision maker who will not substantially change consensus recommendations from the group. It's important, why are you doing what you're doing, and why are you inputting to a process? Some other food for thought, collaborative action, a question, why are you engaging? Are you engaging to understand and collaborate and build trust to create change for a collective, consensus-based goal or objective, policy process, national process, or are you trying to take control over a process, or in some cases, are you trying to take control over internet infrastructure? And the reason I bring this up is that we have seen many collaborative, open, bottom-up processes work, governance processes, particularly with internet exchange points and that infrastructure development, which is not run by a government. Government may be involved to help facilitate, but it's usually run by a multi-stakeholder community of interest, whether they're ISPs, IXPs, civil society, all together. But when government's involved, can government facilitate? In some instances, absolutely, but should it control? And if it does control, is it controlling for the good, or is it controlling to take over the infrastructure? This is a concern that has come up in many contexts, whether it's a treaty context, if you look at the ITRs. Are you going together in a meeting to come together for a treaty that helps facilitate high-level principles, or is it something that's coming in to take control? We have to think very hard about what that might mean. Collaborative action, examples of collaborative action where government has come together with industry or private partnerships to help encourage investment in infrastructure in a country. Civil society, in some instances, has come together. A woman from India this morning during the Access panel spoke about the importance of empowerment, different projects to bring villages together for mobile connectivity. That's a different example. Civil society-based, working with a village or a region. We have domestic and local solutions that have led the way for infrastructure purposes. With respect to IXPs, we know that open, transparent, inclusive, and collaborative governance has worked. It is very difficult to build that trust, and that's something that the Internet Society has seen on the ground. We are grateful to colleagues that we've worked with over the years to build those infrastructures of trust, but it takes time and a lot of dialogue. I would say that it's not something that happens during one conversation. If you're building an IXP, we've seen that it takes 2 years sometimes for stakeholders to talk and to collaborate. In addition to that collaborative governance, which is open, transparent, inclusive, those are some of the best principles we've seen. Is it consensus-based that allows innovation, change, and facilitates growth? You know, why are you doing what you're doing, and is that infrastructure flexible enough to allow for these innovation, change, and growth? With respect to a process, I think we've seen them all throughout different activities we've been involved in. Again, is it an open consultation? Is there transparency in the proceedings? Are you including all stakeholders? Do you reconsult, which means after you've spoken with each other one time or talked to each other, do you go back? Because you can always change a process. That's one thing I've seen regulators that are very afraid when they're putting a recommendation together or a regulation. If you don't talk to the stakeholders and you make a recommendation, you could absolutely hurt the infrastructure and the infrastructure development and or the stakeholder processes that are going on. Allow the change, and don't try to control the entire process. Sometimes it's a very difficult process. People can get very angry with each other in the first instances. You almost have to let it continue in that energy to build toward that trust factor. That's where I'm going to leave off and turn to Paul, who has a more specific example. But I've given you some broad ideas. We know for a fact, I just want to go back to IXPs for a minute, we do know for a fact that there are trust models that work, open, transparent, consultative, and flexible. And again, we've seen this around the world, so it's not just in one part of the globe.
Thanks, Jane. Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I'm Paul Rendick from the RIFE NCC. I'm going to try to first take us up a little bit and out into this big bubble that we're working in right now, and then I would like to get down into the specifics of what Jane has said and give you an example of what I think works, or one model that we can consider. I think when you look at the questions that Kasai has asked us, when you see the idea of improving the internet for all relevant stakeholders, how is it possible to improve the internet for all relevant stakeholders if all relevant stakeholders do not have a place? That's the first question. I think that's a fundamental question. I think everybody in the room can agree on that. That's something we probably don't need to debate. I think if we look at where we are now, I think we've spent a lot of time, all the different stakeholders, taking a look at internet governance and internet administration. It's been a very long road the last couple of years of what I would call a popularity contest. And that is every single stakeholder group running around to all of these large meetings, such as the Internet Governance Forum, trying to find out what their role and what their place is in internet governance and internet administration. It's been a very almost chaotic set of years that are behind us. I've been lucky enough to follow this process from the beginning, from the WSIS times, but I can see that where we are now, we've managed to come together. I think everybody has tried to put their place in what they feel is their role in internet administration or internet governance, and we finally are able to sit down and have some positive dialogue. Wow. We have very different sectors that come together here. We have the government sector, which operates in one way. We have, for instance, the technical community or civil society operates in another way. And I think that at the beginning, we were really banging heads, trying to see where we came together. It was almost a little bit of anger, I think, at the beginning. I think when you come now, here we are at the 7th IGF, there isn't so much anger around. I think people are understanding what is the process of the different groups that we have. You understand how you would approach these groups. You've even actually managed to make contacts so that you can have public and private sector workings or private and public sector dialogues that seem to be progressive and positive. Wow. That's taken us, if you take a look at the time frame that this has been, in my opinion, it's been a relatively short time frame. So you can see, again, that there are movements like this happening. I can say that for the technical community, this was a very difficult process for us to jump into. And I think I can explain why. If you look at what Jane was outlining, collaborative efforts, I'd like to point out a group or a way of internet governance functioning that has actually taken place over the last 20 years. Catch that, 20 years. And that is actually the policy development inside the technical RIPE community, inside the community that is responsible for allocating internet number resources inside a very large group. In fact, the RIRs, if some of you are familiar with the regional internet registries, they are the organizations that allocate the autonomous system numbers and the IP addresses, both IP version 4, where we still have the free pool left, and IP version 6, of course, globally. Now, the RIPE NCC, one of the first regional internet registries around, actually is something that's relatively new compared to RIPE. The RIPE and the collaborative process of people coming together and discussing issues and looking at what were the issues regarding internet networking back in the day, I'm talking 20 years ago, was an open and an inclusive and a collaborative process. So this model exists for quite some time. I think that that's probably why you would see, for those of you that have had any deliberations with the technical community, that it may look a little stubborn, or it may look and say, oh, we don't understand why these processes are so complicated, because this is something we've been doing for years and years. Now, I'm not saying that this is the perfect model or this is the only model that's there, but I think that if you look at what's been achieved over the time span, and the fact that this kind of collaborative work has been able to embrace any kind of changes or any kind of new players that have come into the internet ecosystem, I think it's worth taking a stronger look at. So one of the things I wanted to say is that I think, you know, again, you have differing opinions here, and we have those that are supporting this model, and we even have certain governments that are adopting these kinds of open and collaborative models inside, and we're seeing great progress happening. But again, we're also seeing some governments or even some other parties that are actually pushing this kind of a model away and don't want to see this happening. I think at some stage, in order for the internet to develop the way we'd all like to see it happening, we're going to have to come together. There's no way that any one party can do this over any other. So I'm happy to see that in a process like the IGF, that this model has pretty much been adopted the way that we can see it happening in all of these different areas. And I think that any of you that have followed this process could probably see some of the positive things that have come out of this. Now, we're looking at this whole system here from a global perspective, and we're all trying to exchange the information and see what we can gather here. That's great. But if we look at one of the questions that Kasai pointed out, he said, you know, are there national or regional frameworks that can be developed that are there that would help us with finding our way forward with internet governance? Of course. I think it's actually impossible to try to come together in just a global forum and say, oh yes, we've come together, we've discussed, we've solved. No way. The world just does not work that way. And if I can go back again to the model and go down a little bit, as you can see, there are these different regional internet registries. They operate very differently under the same model of this open dialogue and collaborative work. But the consensus that's reached in the different regions is very different. And when you come to the outcomes of how you know, the administration of the internet works inside of these different areas, why? Because the world is a different place. I think that has to be celebrated, right? So I think that we need to look at these regional and national areas and understand that these models can be brought here, and then this work can be brought to the global level and exchanged. Only then can you have good development coming from what you see from different regions and people sharing this. And I'm seeing this happening out of the IGF. In fact, I am involved with my own organization in making sure that we are where we have to be inside of all of this big region of 76 countries that we have to operate in, and making sure that we can have collaborative efforts based on wherever anyone is in their model. So I do believe that this works, this collaborative process works. So this was one of the things that I did want to point out. I think that this is the contribution that I'd like to make from that level, from that point. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you, Jane, for your interventions and input into this subject, which is useful and really enlightening. I'll shift to our the perception from our side, really, and what triggered the idea of this workshop. If we went through the events that we went through in the Arab world, the Arab Spring, and related to the internet, we will find that we have two, let's say, sides, the people and the state. The state is in a side and the people in a different side. While the internet has been used effectively by people to express and organize themselves, the state shifted toward manipulating internet access, manipulating the openness of the internet based on state interest. It may look legitimate at a point, and it may look illegitimate at a point, but it manipulated access and openness on the way it perceives what is the state interest. Sometimes the state interest is for the good of the people, sometimes it may not necessarily be for the good of the people. And also, we have realized that the internet itself became the target. It's not the social or economical conditions that triggered an event, or it's not the circumstances that triggered the event, but rather the state looked at the internet as the target or the source of the problem. It's a kind of a misconception. It was viewed, it has been looked at in different levels. Not all the states were very harsh on the internet, but the internet was a target during these events. While for the people, the internet was the tool to address their problems, to address the social and economical condition. So at one side, the social economical, someone attempt to move away from the social economical condition and made the internet as the target. From the other side, the people side, no, this was the tool for me to address the social or economical conditions. So this triggered the idea of how to balance the interest of people and the interest of the state. A framework of principles may assist us in build a common understanding on internet issues among all stakeholders. We can agree that these are the issues that we want to address. This is the issues of a priority or a national level or a regional level. A framework and principle on a high level can be a guideline for us in a case like that. A framework of a principle can allow us to overcome the incapability of a specific stakeholder group, not necessarily governments, not necessarily the private sector, not necessarily the CS. We all have at a point incapabilities to overcome in dealing with issues related to internet. So overcoming our incapability or limitations, let's say, because we are acting collectively. It can also put a limit on regulation. Not necessarily regulation should touch every aspect of the internet. There are some aspects where the regulation is the proper mean, and some aspects there are other means that we can address specific issues. A framework of a principle can allow us to outreach bigger groups. It can allow us to build consensus or have a mechanism to build consensus. It can improve participation. It allows us to listen to others. And we need to listen to others because what we have experienced from the year and a half in the past is that there are some groups that we omitted. We just did not outreach them. We just did not open a dialogue with them. Just has been omitted or taken out of the scene, let's say. And more of all, we can understand what the common, the people need. Individuals and people may not necessarily belong to a specific stakeholder group. They are just common internet users, but they have concerns. They have things in mind. This allows us to address them and understand them. Moving from that, and I just pointed to a point which is limit on regulation. Why I'm talking about a limit on regulation. First, and let's be realistic. The internet is too big to be regulated. As a user, I would say it is too big to be regulated. It is also user-centric. The user seek, receive, impart, and create content. This is why the internet became so big, because we contribute as well as we take. Internet is going through a constant change. This week is not like the next week. This month is not like the month after. In 2003, nobody knew about social networks in our part of the world. In 2005, we have millions of users in Facebook. In 2007, we have millions of users in Twitter. And something is coming down the road, definitely. So it's a changing environment. And we all know that regulation cannot keep the pace with the changes that's going with technology, with internet, and with its type of use. But does that mean we need to say that regulation doesn't have a place? No, absolutely not. Regulation is still a proper tool for many things. Infrastructure. When we talk about rights, such as consumer rights, defining what is a cybercrime, a privacy, this is the places where regulation should take place because it's building a trust. So whenever we need to build the trust on the internet, maybe the best way so far we have is building, is regulating things. So if we oriented the regulation toward building a trust in electronic transaction and the way we use the internet, that's of course will be, we will see that always regulation will play a positive role toward the internet. And the contrary, we need to balance that with the user rights. So if I oriented the regulation toward, let's say, accountability, toward issues like legitimizing electronic transaction, e-commerce, e-signatures, addressing issues related to privacy, identity management to an extent, this is the places where regulation cannot be, it would be the best approach. While, on the contrary, if I shifted regulation toward the openness of the internet, toward somehow restricting access to the internet, affecting the way I express myself, or let's say put limits on innovation and so on, then the regulation will go toward the other direction. It is taking the trust factor away. So when we say a limit on regulation, we are not saying take it out. We are saying regulation should be always directed toward building a trust. And if we kept it into that criteria, it will always play a positive and, let's say, an encouraging role. Moving from that, what other options that we can have? We're talking about limited regulation, so what we can have on the other side? Governance. Governance as an option in many issues or areas that we are we may apply regulation to. So why governance would be an option? First, the word governance or the concept of governance, whether it was in internet, in corporations, or so on, it was always inclusive, transparent, multi-stakeholder, it engages in a dialogue, and this allows us to bring all relative parties together to reach a consent and what we want on a national level or a regional level or from the internet. And this can be institutionalized somehow. Maybe someone will be against the institutionalization, but it can be institutionalized and it can come instead of an institutionalization, it can become, let's say, a common best practice that is always used. Governance is always based on frameworks. It is always based on principles. If we looked at the Geneva Declaration of a Principle, it always gave us a framework today. When we say how we link ICT to development, we always refer to the action lines of Geneva Declaration of a Principles. And we say, this is the framework that ICT can play a role in development. Somehow it worked, and it is improving. It is proving that it's working, although it is 7 years old right now, and it's talking about technology that's shifting and changing. So governance is always depending on something that is flexible, like frameworks, principles, code of conducts, best practices. And these are all high level. It gives us a kind of a flexibility to deal with. It can give us a space to interpret it to our benefit, not to orient it toward, let's say, the interests of a specific stakeholder group, but it can always create the balance that can be acceptable to all, rather than using regulation which works by laws or bylaws or rules or procedure and it create for us a bureaucracy. Other than that, governance allows us to create a policy. For 7 years on the global IGF, we are talking up. It's a platform for policy dialogue. It doesn't have an outcome, that's true, but it affected all the players that is around the internet. If we saw the organizations that is involved with internet or internet governance 7 years ago and how they are today, they are more open, they are more inclusive, they are more transparent, maybe not to the expectation of someone, that's the truth, but they are more open, more transparent, more inclusive, and you will find that it is mostly because these organizations, they have a platform for policy dialogue, they met with other stakeholders, they listened, and they tried to accommodate to change as much as they could. And it's still ongoing. So governance can work on that term, in creating policies and creating the consensus. Now, if we give the chance to move toward governance rather than regulation, what opportunities we can have? It can do the following. First, we always look at governments as this stakeholder that always is stopping the internet development, the internet expansion, and governments are doing so and so and so, and they are hurting the users. But actually, with the government approach, their role will be much appreciated. They will have an opportunity to have a more representative umbrella that reflects the interests of all stakeholder groups. And this is what we want. The governments are the legitimate representative of people. They are the representatives of all stakeholder group interests, and they need to reflect that. And with governance, their role will be more appreciated, more closer, and they'll bring more people. We will be able more to realize national priorities or interests related to internet and related to internet governance. Governance will allow us to listen to others and see what is most what is the most important issues that comes to their mind, whether civil society or the private sector or the other government entities and let's say other individuals. Because governance always starts from a dialogue, and this will let us more closer to these stakeholder groups who would spell out their concerns and what they want to see. It allows us to create a participatory process that is transparent and will transfer the internet or the internet governance in a real public consultation tool. One of the problems that there is a gap between the government and the common, and it triggered the events in some of the in some location of the Arab world, is that there was a gap between the bureaucratic governmental thinking and between the people or the other groups, and nobody made the extra mile or the extra step to break this gap and listen to the other. For the government, this will allow them to transfer this internet, this IG process, into a public consultation tool that will always listen to what other stakeholders want or worried about or looks as a shortcoming from the government or as a positive aspect from the government. And of course, like in the last 5-6 years, we rarely saw a public consultation that goes through the internet in our part of the world, at least. That will lead us to an improved relation among all stakeholders that can make the government a better umbrella for all stakeholders. Eventually, on a national level, it will create a framework for enhanced cooperation. And that's the role of the government. If we looked at paragraph 69 of the Tunis Agenda, we will look that it's asking government to conduct policy development with all stakeholders. So with a governance process based on a transparent, inclusive, multi-stakeholder approach, we on a national level can say what enhanced cooperation means to us, nationally, locally. rather than jumping immediately to, let's say, the international scene or the global scene. My last part is, do we have examples? Of course. We're not reinventing the wheel. Brazil is a leading example. They, long time ago, they have a framework of a principle, and they structured their internet around that framework of principles from the regulatory side, from the operational side, from the social and economical side. They have a full structure that is based on an internet governance approach. It starts from NIC.br. That's a national example. Do we have an example on civil society? Of course. The Internet Rights and Principle Coalition, maybe many of you didn't hear about, they created at a point what is called the Principles of Internet Governance. And it is there on the net, actually. Just go and access it. A regional example, what the Council of Europe has developed, I guess, in December 2011. They launched what is called the Internet Governance Framework of Principles that is and adopted, actually, by the member states of the Council of Europe. It is intergovernmental, true, but it was based on a multi-stakeholder inclusive model. Another example is the OECD, although civil society has reservations on that model, and they did have, but at least the OECD did develop a framework of. These are all examples that we can look at and learn from, and maybe reflected on a national or a regional level. And I will end it with, we would not be able to know what we want from internet governance on a global level if we don't know what we want from internet governance on a regional level. And we would not know what we want from internet governance on a regional level if we don't have our national priorities on internet government set. So really, the start is always from our national interest on internet governance. That can we move it to the regional level, and then we move it to the global level. Beyond that, we'll always have a gap. To this, I reach the conclusion of my intervention, and I'll pass it to our wonderful panelist, Dr. Olga Cavalli from Argentina. Thank you.
Thank you, Gusai, and thank you for being late, but I was panelist in other workshops, so I told to both organizers that I was going to be rude in another one and late in this one. So thinking about your words and thinking about what is happening about regulation, and I think that I've spent a fairly important time of my professional life in trying to coordinate things among people and trying to put people together. I have been an advisor to the government of my country for 10 years so far. It's funny because I started with for a 2 month small activity. And since then, being a person from the academic side and from the private sector, the government gave me a fantastic experience of new knowledge and new levels of complexity. And what I realized is that things are organized sometimes in a very silo style working methodology. And it is not easy to move from there because there are several things already established in the international, for example, international meetings. Why some countries are not so much interested in being in ICANN? And I have talked to my government several times and I said, okay, you should go there. You are the one that understand those acronyms and they are very difficult. And why should we go? Well, there is an advisory committee where the governments are there and they have a say. To the board of ICANN. Well, but you're the only one who understands that, so you should go. I said, okay, fine, but I mean, there are other people in the government that should be involved. So it's difficult to move away from a specific way of thinking once that's established in the governmental agenda. Other thing that I have tried to coordinate with some success is with other ministries. I am advisor of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and at the same time, other people from the Ministry of Infrastructure go to the ITU meetings. So we do coordinate about ICANN and ITU activities, although we don't go to the same meetings. So sometimes in the year we sit together and we exchange information. So now for the visit meeting in Dubai, I am not part of the official delegation, but we have some time for coordination. And also, and I've been saying this in several workshops, I think that we have to develop, we have to learn more than before. When I went to the university, I studied, I'm an engineer, and I wanted to be an engineer just because I like mathematics. And then when I finished my career, I realized it was not about mathematics, it was about other things. It was about projects and doing things and dealing with teams of working and politicians and rules and regulations. So mathematics was far beyond in my desires, gone forever, perhaps. And that is something that we have to learn, that when we do this multi-stakeholderism and we do this binding with, or we try to do this binding and relationship to build the regulations, we have to think multi-stakeholder as well. We have to learn other things. I had to learn regulations, and I didn't like it at the beginning because I'm an engineer, and I said, why should I? I'm not a lawyer. Why should I do this? But I have to, and it's very important. So perhaps, and I am also a university teacher, and I find this also in universities. Universities still think in a very, in subjects. I teach networking, and many of my colleagues that do teach networking with me don't know about ICANN. They know that there is are in the region, it's LACNIC, but they don't know about IANA, ICANN, that relate. And why should I know about? Well, they provide the IP addresses, and they're changing from IPv4, IPv6. Oh, yeah, really? And they do meetings, and they are very good, and you can participate online. Oh, really? And you're a university teacher, so your students should know about that. And they don't even know about that. So I see the university also a place to work with. Although they are, there are a lot of people that are very, very good academics in their own specialities, they need to learn about other things and to try to blend these things into the university knowledge. And also, it's a very important challenge for the government. I think it's a very difficult challenge for the government. But I'm an optimistic person since I was born, so I am very optimistic. This is why I'm a teacher. I like young people, and I like their energy. So I think that younger people will do the change slowly but surely. But us, that we are the ones young in spirit, not so young in age, we are also need to change this thinking and be more accountable for what we do and think and look at our colleagues and learn from them. I don't know if I was, I'm open to questions and comments. Thank you very much.
I think Paul would like to exchange the views, so I'll pass it to Paul. Thank you.
Thank you. So after all this discussion, tell me, is regulation the bad word of the day? This is kind of what I'm seeing put on the table, not only here, but everywhere I'm kind of floating around. My personal opinion, I don't think regulation is really the bad word. I think we have to find the right kind of mix between maybe what Kasai was bringing forward, you know, internet governance and regulation. I think if you're going to be talking about regulation, I think the most important part to look at it is how do we arrive at it? It's not that you actually build the regulation, but how are you arriving at that regulation? And if I can take us a step backwards, I actually want to maybe point out why we're having or seeing the word regulation coming into play, and maybe why we're seeing internet governance or the ideas of what internet governance means floating at the other side. Firstly, I think everyone needs to understand what the definitions are of the things we're talking about, because the word internet governance, the word enhanced cooperation, the word regulation means very different things to very different people. So I think before you can even start to have any kind of progressive dialogue, you need to be able to point out what everybody's understanding of the definitions are. Otherwise, we're going to be talking around in circles, right? And I think that in many of the deliberations that I've had, throughout IGFs, I haven't quite seen that everybody's on the same playing field and understanding what the different parties believe are the definitions, okay? And then I wanted to back up a little bit. You know, this internet beast that we have in front of us has grown and has snowballed. And I think one of the reasons why we see the word regulation coming in, or the word regulation being such a bad word, is because if you look at this, the internet is something that was given to the governments. This is a very, very scary thought for them, because things like public infrastructures that you see are always projects that are led by government or government bodies. Roads, telephone wires, all of these sorts of things, electricity. These are all government-run big projects for their citizens. The internet, wow, this was not a government project. This thing has snowballed into such a large thing that is so important to the economy of really every country these days. This is, I think, one of the reasons why we see that governments have the compulsion to regulate, because they just don't have a grasp of this thing. And if I look at where the different parts of regulation are, if I follow the way that the Europeans are doing it or the way that the Arabs are doing this, everybody's in a different cycle of their development. It's not necessarily that regulation's right or wrong. I think that the different areas of where everyone is in their development is where they would pounce on this and try to put the regulation there to understand maybe what this means for their economy, for their citizens, for their culture even, for instance. So I think that if you want to reach the word regulation or understand what that is, I think you have to look at how you're arriving at it. So whether it's the internet governance idea that Kasai has pointed out, or even the regulation idea, why can't both have the same components? I think that if you look at ways that things are reached these days, having smaller task forces or having smaller working groups with different multi-stakeholders involved to give governments what they need to make the correct public policy and regulation, in my opinion, from what I've seen, certainly in the European countries where I've been involved in this, it's been actually quite positive. And then I think people accept regulation because it's something that they understand how you arrived at that point, right? And you understand that it's good for the development of the country and making sure that your country is developing its internet. One of the big questions that I ask when I go to TRAs or when I visit ministries of various countries from the technical community perspective is that I ask them, these policies and the regulation that you're putting into place here, what kind of an internet are you going to leave for your children and the next generation if they cannot compete and cooperate on the world scene? And they're already doing this behind your back. So if you're not leaving this for them, what kind of a legacy are you leaving as a leader? And this is what we need to ask ourselves with where we're going with regulation, internet governance. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. And thank you, Olga, for your descriptive governmental role. We need to engage in a dialogue, and this is the time of engagement, really, with the participants and attendees. So I would really would like to pass the floor to you for comments, questions, or perceptions. So, Dr. Hussain, sir.
Hossein Badran from Cisco. Thank you very much for the very, very interesting and enlightening arguments presented by the very experienced speakers. I just wanted to point out to a comment I heard from Jane that also matches my experience working in the Middle East for many years. Governments in some instances open the door for consultation and getting feedback from the constituents and the stakeholders, private sector, and in some cases also civil society. But we see that this process is mostly one way in terms of the arguments and the points of views are being received. But the outcome of this consultation is not really reflected in the final regulation text, in the final regulation framework. And this lack of transparency and lack of effectiveness is turning people off in terms of engagement in the process. We hope that after the Arab Spring and after the change of the political scene, and that the role of the public is so much higher now than it used to be maybe a few years ago, that this would change. We have an opportunity in some countries in the Middle East to affect change, because many of the laws that have been drafted years ago are now under re-evaluation and they're being rewritten. In some countries, like in Egypt, actually rewriting the constitution as a whole. So hopefully the governments will take the public interest and the public arguments into consideration when drafting these laws. We are reviewing the telecom law in Egypt at the moment, and we had the killer switch allowance in that law, and also the open blanket for security agencies to get into tapping people and getting their information. We had sessions of consultation of a draft version of the law, but unfortunately we have not seen yet a second draft that takes our comments into consideration. And this is very important. Governments need to understand that yes, opening a door to feedback is not the end of the process. It's the beginning of the process. Also, Paul has mentioned this very eloquently. It's the beginning of the process, and people need to see that their concerns are reflected in the final outcome. Of course, the wicked process, again, is still a one-way communication, and I've heard from one of the regulators in the Middle East that to a leading operator, you have been invited to give your comment. The operator said, yes. You gave your comment. He said, yes. That's it. That's the end of the process. Now it's our job to come up with what we see fit. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hussein. Sir.
Thank you. My name is Yaovi. I want to add my voice to make a comment to say as in Paul's last remark, he said something very, very important, and is the definition of term. Because something's happening is that we start talking about an issue, and we don't have the same definition. And then we spend many days, many weeks, many years talking because everybody has a different view on the subject. So I think that is something very important we have to emphasize on in IGF issues. We can say, people will say, we are going to organize IGF every year because people are talking about IGF. What are people talking about when they organize IGF? We are going to organize IGF every 6 months to say what? So I think the definition, as you said, is very, very important point. And then we need to understand first what we want to talk about before starting the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ayman? Jane would like to reply.
I would like to thank the last speaker and make an observation. I used to work in Moldova, which is a country over near Ukraine, and I was working with the regulator. And I brought up the word stakeholder. Now, I was living in a part of the world, which is next door to Romania, which is famous for Dracula. Now, with Dracula, there is a thing called a stake, and they put it in his heart, right? It's a wooden piece that is very hard and sharp. So I said, well, we have to bring the stakeholders together. And they looked at me, and they said, is this meat that you're talking about? Are you holding a steak, like tuna or beef? Or are you talking about steaks that you put into someone's, if it's a vampire, if they exist? Is it a thing that makes the tomatoes stand up in your garden? So what is a stakeholder? And I will tell you, I went on Wikipedia before coming here. Multi-stakeholder, look at it on your computers right now. You won't find it. It's not on Wikipedia. And I thought, gosh, do we all have the same definition? Mm-hmm. And to your point, this is very important. There are definitions online. I got my collective governance definition there. But we do have to understand every country is so different. We come from different religious and social and governance cultures. And when Kusai says regulation, as someone that used to regulate, and I think about the internet, and I think about Vint Cerf, who says it's permissionless innovation that the internet allows, what are we talking about when we're talking about governance of this thing? Yeah. As Kusai has said, you can't govern the entire internet. It's different. It has different networks and instantiations when you see it. But what is it that you're talking about? So it's a very important point you raise, because we could absolutely misunderstand each other, particularly with our own languages as well. So thank you. That's very important. And maybe that's something that we think about moving forward. What are we talking about when we say we're coming together to talk about X or Y or Z?
Ayman, my dear colleague, and my dear colleague, and then Sal.
Okay, Kosai and dear colleagues, dear participants, I'm Ayman Sherbini from the United Nations ESQA. I'm responsible for the ICT policies in the United Nations for West Asia and North Africa, and I'm one of the co-founders of the Arab IGF. I have had the chance during the Arab IGF that took place last month in Kuwait to be on a similar panel discussing the regulation aspect. And I recall my views during that time. I will add some new ideas based or inspirations from the panelists. I think that, use the word of Paul, it is not a bad word. Regulating is not a bad word. In fact, what we are trying to do now is regulating the concept of regulation. We are trying to regulate the cognitive concept, the very concept of it. I think in a very simple view, regulation is avoiding collision. I mean, if there is, look at it as like traffic signs or thing like that. If there is no collision, if things are flowing normally, then there is no need. I think it can be looked at in a positive sense, where it is just a service that can or may be offered by a government just to stand to up to their duties. So if there is a need, then it should be there. Otherwise, absence of regulation can create a problem. So maybe some of the people who have been involved in regulating the telecom dimensions, they have certain understanding, others they don't have it. But generally, if you look at it from a telecom perspective, it is very useful. I mean, even if you look at the RIRs, it has been doing regulation a certain way or another. So regulation is not predominantly government, other side of a coin for a government. Regulation is a service that is needed when you want to distribute resources or to avoid collisions or things like that. And I like the word of Windsurf when you say impermissible or innovation without permission. Yes, this is true. We don't need it as an a priori phenomena. We don't need permission for innovation. But if the innovation is there and it creates collision, and in a network professor, you know, collision detection thing. So if there is a collision, maybe this innovation that would come at a certain point in time might need some regulation. So we don't have to be frightened of the word. And I would like to move to the other point I want to bring to the audience, is that according to the title of the panel today, which is National Regional Frameworks for Principles, we have an experience according to our specificity in the Arab region. We have come up with a certain framework, and we called it a roadmap for internet governance in the Arab region. And in the roadmap, we had put goals and certain measures for the attainment of the goals. And before that, in the preamble, in the very first chapter, we put principles. And we inherited the principles that Kosai has been referring to from the Brazilian experience, which is some bullet points. Democratic and collaborative governance is a principle. Innovation is a principle. Unaccountability of the network and universality. So some very high level principles. And we used this as a preamble to the framework. So I think this was really well accepted by the region. And it boils down, end of the day, it is something like a constitution or a constitutional declaration from which we can produce laws or bylaws or whatever. I think the very frightening thing for regulation is its speed. Some people think that it is going to hinder. So if the regulation itself is dynamic enough, it has a process that it is dynamic and it is following up all the changes, I think it would turn into a positive word, and the gap between the regulation level and the governance layer would really shrink. So the very idea of Kosai, which is the notion of principles, I supported so much that very simple principle, few bullet points that represent lowest common denominator for everyone is enough for every constituency to produce its own frameworks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ayman. I just wanted to respond to that. You've just made a fantastic point. You've made a point that one part of a region in a different time, in a different space of development, has taken a look at something that was done somewhere else, looked at it, and then thought, how does this fit or not fit us, and what would we do for our region? Fantastic. That's exactly what we're talking about here. And again, I'm happy that you made the point of regulation not being a bad word, because although for someone like me, I should be sitting up here saying, regulation, oh my God, get it away from me. But that's really not how I'm thinking. I'm actually more in the thinking of how do we arrive at it, which is what you're pointing out. I think that if you come to the regulation at a point where it's done, where everyone can understand it, and hopefully it's transparent enough, people will accept it. I mean, it's something that's brought forward there. And again, I think that for the development and the stages of development and what you're leaving behind as an internet for your next generation is very important here. Thank you. Thanks for making those points.
And just as an extra point, the roadmap that was my dear colleague Eamon referred to was done by the UNESCOA, which is the regional commission of the UN for Western Asia, and it was the base of the program that we developed for the Arab IGF. I'll go to my colleague, you, Salam, and then sir.
Thank you.
Please go ahead. Can you introduce yourself?
Yes, my
please?
Name is Makan Fay. I am from the UN Economic Commission for Africa. ECA, the sister of ESCOA in the African continent. We are also the convener with the African Union of the African IGF, and we have developed what we call the terms of reference. It is just like the roadmap Ayman is referring to. And our terms of reference was based on the paragraph 72 of the Tunis Agenda. That is what we based on. And then we came up with fundamental principles. Openness, that was the first one. All organizations and institutions shall be free to join the forum. That's what we did. Multi-stakeholdership. We encourage all stakeholders, government, civil society, academia, technical communities, private sector, regional and international organizations also to join. And language diversity, because we are in a continent where we have several languages, where we wanted everybody to participate according to its own language. Transparencies also, we said that the stakeholders shall strive to be open in communication, in decisions, and in their implementation. So that was part of it. And of course, remote participation also was there to enable people who are not there to be able to take part. During our meeting we held in Cairo from 2 to 4 of October, we had national IGFs who have made presentation. We have also what we call the sub-regional IGF, where we have five African sub-regions, north, south, east, central, west, southern also, which have participated. And some of the issues which were raised from the national IGF was that I think it is very important to state. Prior consultation is needed to identify the national actor whose attributes, experience, and expertise makes it the most suitable to play the role of the convener. Because we need to have a convener at the national level. And in some countries, you find the government just going alone, or one private sector, or one civil society going it alone. But this multi-stakeholder partnership should be also the norm at the national level as it was at the African regional level. And we had agreed also at that the basis for discussion at the national fora should be topics of national importance for the country, should be the starting point before they go out looking for the IGF teams or of the African IGF of teams. And they also agreed that they should have online discussions before coming to the face-to-face meetings to make necessary preparations and so on. And also we agreed that the capacity building should be continuous throughout the process during the national IGF and the regional IGF. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, sir.
Are you getting me?
Yeah. My name's Edmond Yakane. I came from South Sudan. And I'm a civil society activist. And I'm among the activists who recently started looking into issues of internet governance, and I'm a student of law. First, I do agree with you. The word regulation is not a bad word. Should not be a scaring word. The problem is, how do you arrive to it? And in issue of internet governance, if you want to arrive to regulations now, there's a key let me say, legal concepts need to look into. Criminology, how do you define something as a criminal in the use of internet? If we talk of blockage, how do you define it in internet world? If you talk of like issues of permits, legal permits in the issue of internet, how do you find it? And then at a level whereby, like in my country, South Sudan, where we are really building up new constitution, new policies, but the lawmakers, their age is not the age of internet. If you tell them there's internet rights, internet freedom, then they start asking you, what are you talking about it? So it's a question of really, for me, the term, I'm just supporting the same thing what my colleagues have said behind me is the idea. Yeah, it's the same thing. It's an issue of definitions. We need to really, really define it, and we need to be in one page. If we talk, we are multi-stakeholders. We need to be in one page because sometimes definitions make us get confused, and sometimes definitions start building in us spirit of resistance. We start resisting. What do you mean exactly? For me, this is nonsense. For me, this sounds a different thing. So yes, I'm adding my voice to the same thing that there's a need for us really to have a clear definition. As I said, multi-stakeholders, is it there on the internet? In my context, what does it mean? For my lawmakers, what does it mean? For me, what does it mean? So thank you very much.
Thank you. And if the panelist wants to reply to that, we'll go to Salam. Okay.
One quick point. I would say regulators have to have the confidence also not to regulate, right?
Yeah.
Because if something's working, if something's not broken, if it's not broken, don't try and break it more, right? One thing that I would add to the colleague from UNECA, some regions have had, or continents, I will point to the African Union, and a colleague is in the back, August, have had the strength to take a look and work with the internet community to try and create a pan-African idea of how internet exchange points should be put together. And it's not just one way, as Paul is saying, there are lots of ways. But they've had the strength to make a decision to work with different interest groups to try and help create that infrastructure. And they're not trying to drive it in a certain direction, but just let it grow, but working with governments and stakeholders across Africa. So they deserve some great credit for the hard work that they're doing, and we're very proud to be working with them on that.
Yes, good morning. My name is Salam Yamut. I am from Lebanon. I have double hat. I work with the government, but also I represent the ISOC chapter in Lebanon. My question was partly answered by my friend Ayman about the overlaying principle. So really talking about three things. We're talking about the mechanism by which we do the open consultation and what it means. We're talking about the regulations, but we also were talking about the principles overlaying the regulations. And in my government limbo language, this means policies, right? So, and this is something I'm really interested in. Maybe I'm interested in how do you then, we know how to regulate because you issue laws, right? Or regulations to the TRA, but how do you instate policies at government's level so that they are national, regional, coherent? Do we, what is the mechanism by which we take such a roadmap that ESQA prepared, maybe customize it a bit more for Lebanon and make it law or make it binding?
So if you can, so Salam, if I can understand your intervention, you said, you're talking about how to conduct open consultations, doing regulation, and what the principles that we should follow in doing regulation, which means eventually policy development. So, and this policy development, how can we make it binding, or we can customize it?
I guess it's the last question because the other questions were already answered. We went through how to make. But basically is how to go through the, and here's the question, how to make the policy binding, what you call the framework, and is it necessary or not? I mean, at the end of the day, in the context of what we are talking about today.
Well, I will go to Ayman, and then I'll pass the floor to Paul, Olga, and Jay.
Thank you, Salam. I'm very happy to bring this point because it is like the kernel of the story. I mean, how to make principles in motion. I mean, how to put these principles into reality from the debate into reality. I think these few principles are constitutional style material. It is something like a charter. I mean, if we have done that on a regional level, we can do it also on a national level. We create a certain national dialogue on the very three, four, five main principles that this nation thinks that the internet should be governed under. For example, network neutrality or accountability or innovation openness and things like that. And then a certain declaration by stakeholders goes out, like what you have done in the manifesto and the broadband thing like that. And you do this national Lebanese charter for internet principles. By this, it takes like a certain power of a constitution. From that, policies will be driven afterwards. So this was the experience on the regional level. And I think it can be a very simple model to be done on national level. And if we have these charters here and there, we create this lowest common denominator wherever we go. And I think this, what makes sense at the end of the day, would be common sense to every nation believing in the model. We have done it on the regional level, and our plan is to do it on national level. We can help Lebanon, and we move and make it a model on that from regional to national principle frameworks.
I'll give the floor to Olga, then to, you want to start with Paul? Olga, you can start.
Thank you very much. About this principle issue, and it's very interesting what you said, do we need them, we don't need them. I come from a country, there are many people protesting in north of Africa. We have seen this in the Arab Spring. I come from a country that had happened before in 2002, had a big crisis and the government went down because of we were hitting our pot in the streets, what we called cacerolazo. So I know what I'm talking about. And about internet governance, we were present in WSIS. I was part of the national delegation, and we adhere to the Tunis documents. We never sit together in Argentina to write these principles. But what happened since WSIS is that many things are concrete now. We have a project, a national project of I'm bad with numbers in English, 7,000 kilometers of fiber optic installed in the whole country with a very high capillarity. And that was not written in a certain principle, but we followed somehow the WSIS momentum. We also have a national digital TV project, which is free for everyone, of high quality digital TV. It's free for everyone. Cable TV is very expensive, but this is full content all interests. So my comment is that there may be principles or there may be not. The interesting thing is that if things are moving on, do not create a regulation that may ban it or stop it. And sometimes you don't need to sit together and establish the principle. And sometimes it happens. Sometimes you need to do it because sometimes you need to, for example, internet exchange points in Argentina, we have many. And that is something that has been blessed by the government, but the government never intervened, but they like it. And it's something that came from the private sector. And so principles were not nationally established, but they happen. Thank you.
I just wanted to make a very quick intervention to this because I know that we have to wrap up and we're late for lunch. I'm sure you want to wrap this up. To what I've experienced kind of, I guess, in the last year and a bit that I've been in the Arab world, what I see when you're trying to reach your policies there, I think what happens a lot is that you're seeing this kind of open consultation with groups because I think it's kind of the popular thing to do these days. And I'm seeing it happening in the Arab world, but what I see that's a little bit different from maybe what I've experienced in some European countries where I've been involved is that they already have cooked everything that they have to cook, and then they bring everyone together, show it, and then they walk off, and that's what's proposed, or that's what ends up being put into the policies or the regulation. I'm not really quite sure if that's going to win you anything. Really, you might as well not really even go through the process, because I think you're just making people angry, really. But I think that if you can have the process. I mean, look, for instance, I spend so much time when I go to these certain government meetings where they're talking about regulation and policies, and they're always like, ooh, technical community, here you are. I'm sure you're going to slam us with something that's going to derail this because you're from that technical community. I always kind of see this idea. That's at least how we had it at first in Europe. My explanation back was always, I am not interested in making public policy. Are you kidding? The technical community, we are way too busy running the internet to be involved in making public policy. That's your job. But I'm hoping what I can do here with you is help you make better public policy, right? And I think that's what I'm saying even in my deliberations when I'm going around speaking with governments in the Arab world. I think that you can't just make, and I think this was the point that Hussein was making, that they have these open consultation processes, but everything's really already cooked. I think that creates more anger than anything progressive. Thank you.
One last comment from Sir. The mic, please. Our last comment.
Hello. Is it okay? It's a pleasure to be a last speaker. My name is Petko Kanche from Bulgaria, and I'm advising our own administration. And recently, I am chairing a very interesting group in the ITU, independent expert group on the internet issues. And I'm grasping more and more how sophisticated the internet is and its governance as well. And I fully agree with Jane that multi-stakeholder or stakeholderism even, there is no word like this in any English dictionary, neither in the Wikipedia. I have looked about that. But in our own report of the Secretary General already, there is such a term. So now, there are many terms which are meaning very different things to many people. And what first thing I would like to suggest to you is, via the IGF forum, is perhaps to set up a group of terminology and to agree on this, and then to start using it rightly and to start building on that. Because not having that, I fully agree with Paul, we would not progress at all. Second thing, I would like to bring you back to the history. The radio, the television, the pickup, a turntable, or recorders, the cars, they were never created by incentives from the government. They were created by inventive people. Once Ford did create the car, this was not a government program, but the people started to like it. And then the government started to face the problem, then what we do? Shall we leave it in full anarchy and chaos so that the people will start killing them every day because they move from right and left with any speed and any way, or we shall regulate it somehow? So, the public did agree that the regulation is necessary and it is done. We have a code of conduct, we have traffic lights, we have speed limits, we have everything. And still we have casualties, but they are much less. So now, I don't think that in the internet we have something very special. The principles of progress are applying to the internet space as well. And we need to have some sort of a governance. We need to have some sort of a regulation. The question is, which governance and which regulation? Will this be going to be constructive, stimulating to further development, or will this be going to be handicapping the progress? And that is the thing which we have to make sure that it's not happening. I agree with Paul that if the government would write up some sort of a strategy or regulation, and they put it somewhere hidden in one website for 20 days, and then perhaps they would find one or two comments or not, and they say, this was a public consultation process done. And I agree with him, and this is the real thing which I'm seeing in my country with the digital television introduction, is that this process is leading only afterwards to casualties. The whole thing is to be redone once again. So we have to start involving all the people, all the interested parties, give them the freedom and the forum to fight, to exchange ideas, and then to start understanding each other and to agree to common goals and principles. Now, the last thing which I wanted to say is that still for us, we are not very clear what internet is. For example, cybersecurity issue is not understood at all by many people. Many people, they believe that this is something which is hindering the freedom of expression. It's not that. So in anything in the real life, we are having a regulation, and if something is against the law, against the interest of the human being and the citizens, then the law is applied. So in the internet sphere or space, we have to find out which are those few parameters which could be exchanged internationally so that the quick and voluntary action would be taken by the requested, from the requested government. And this is going to be done on the voluntary basis, if you'd like to, because the predator, I'm calling the hammers or fishers and all the people that got intentions, they may operate in any one country of 192 ITU members. So we have to make sure it's simple, it's mutually acceptable, it's not counterproductive and conflicting with the national legislation and culture. I believe then we would clean up for the progress of the internet and accepting it widely, because believe me or not, this is becoming a basic commodity of life, and we have to make it that this is happening in the right way. Thank you.
Thank you. Any final comments? I'm sure it's lunchtime and we need to wrap up. I would like to thank my wonderful panel. I would just give an applause of hand. Thank you very much, really, for being with us and for the wonderful audience, really. And I hope this workshop was a productive workshop and useful for all of us. Thank you. Thank you.